Getz, can I have your full name, please, and date of birth?
William Ainsworth Getz, and I was born at Holland, Michigan, on August 21st, 1915.
Can you tell us, Mr. Getz, how your family came to White Lake?
Well, my mother's family, the Ainsworth family, were among the original founders of Michelinda. And there were quite a group from Moline, and of course people from Michigan and Indiana, that's where the Michelinda came from. And my father, who was a Chicagoan, ended up, after graduating from the University of Chicago, managing a newly acquired farm of an uncle of his down at Holland, Michigan. My father came up here to visit my mother, to visit a fraternity brother, pardon me, and was staying over at the old Austin Michelinda Pines over there, the old Pines Resort, and he met my mother up here. So that's how the Getz family were from Chicago, the Ainsworth family from Moline, Illinois, and the Ainsworths were the original ones up here.
Were the original ones. Can you tell me what year this was, approximately?
Well, about 1895 is when Michelinda was first founded. It's just, I think we're talking about a centennial here in 95, but I think Michelinda really got going a year or two later, but it's very close to Sylvan Beach in years in existence.
Okay. How many cottages are a part of this
association? 23 at Michelinda, yeah. We're roughly a third the size of Sylvan, I think.
Okay. Are there cottages on here that are not part of the association?
Yes, there are about four or five of them down here on the south end, and then one Wendell Kent's cottage on the north end.
Okay. How did the association get off the ground, basically? You said that your family was founded it, basically.
The story on it is that a congregational minister who had been in Grand Rapids came to the Congregational Church in Moline, and that he was up here visiting a parishioner, a former parishioner from Grand Rapids at Sylvan Beach, and in walking the beach saw this big level piece of property here, and persuaded some of his parishioners in Moline, my great-grandfather Ainsworth among them, to buy this property from Mr. Austin. This was owned by John Austin, who was one of the forerunners of the O'Connells, you know, Dolly and John and Jim and that group.
I see.
Their mother was an Austin. Their grandmother was an Austin.
Did this incorporate as Sylvan Beach did as an association?
Yes.
Under the Michigan State?
Yes, it did.
Okay, and that charter was probably 1895, you're saying?
I'm not sure of the original date of incorporation, but it was right around that time, yeah. And was incorporated as the Michelinda Beach Association, the name which it still operates under.
Okay. Is that up for renewal every 30 years?
The lease is, the property is held in common. We own our individual cottages. The property is held in common, and there are leases that are up for renewal periodically, and I am not exactly sure of the length of term of the leases.
Oh, okay. Going back to your father and your family, what did your father do?
My father graduated as a Greek and Latin scholar from the University of Chicago, and Phi Beta Kappa, I might add, which I didn't ever attain, but he intended to teach, but had a respiratory illness about the time he was graduated from the University of Chicago, and at that time the remedy for the recuperation from a respiratory illness was to get outside work. And this uncle of his had just purchased this farm down at north of the channel, down at Holland, Michigan. And so he said to my father, if you need outside work, why don't you go over and manage the farm for me? Which my father did for a number of years. And then he came up and, came up here on a visit and met mother. They were married, and we lived on the farm at Holland for the first few years of their life. I was born there, and my brother John was born there. Then my father and my grandfather in Moline persuaded my father to come in, and another son-in-law to come in and join the family machinery business down in Moline, Illinois. So That's what my father did. We moved to Moline in 1917, very soon after John was born, Brother John was born, and the family's been there ever since.
Okay. And that's the family business that you still
own? Yes.
Still owns and runs.
Yes.
Can you give me a breakdown of the names of your family members, the immediate family, your brothers, the whole...
Do you mean my generation?
Yeah, your generation.
We had an older brother who died named Henry, who died when he was quite young. And then it's Bill, John, Carol, Sarah, Pamela, Cicely, Barbara, who is deceased now, and Tom.
What did Barbara die of?
Barbara had a stroke when she was in her early 60s.
Okay. What did you do when? Where did you attend school, and what did you do during your life?
Rather notable. I haven't done that. I attended school in Moline, the grade schools and high school there. And I went briefly to Augustana College in Rock Island, Illinois. And then I got out and went to work, and worked until I was about 71. And I worked for a while for International Harvester during the 30s, during the Depression years, and in Rock Island, Illinois. And then joined the family business. Things had picked up there. And we had the two companies in Moline, Williams White & Company Machinery Builder and Moline Forge, which was an offshoot of Williams White. And Tom and I are the two in the family who have been in the family business, and Tom is still there.
So Tom runs it now?
Yes.
You know, one of the most famous people, and certainly one of the most gracious, kind persons that I've ever met up here, was your mother. Can you tell us something about her? Granny Getz.
She was a great gal. She was one of three Ainsworth sisters. There were no sons in that family. That's how my father and another son-in-law, Howard Rogers, happened to be brought into the business by my great-grandfather. But she was born and raised in Moline, and went to school there. Went to college at Oberlin down in Ohio, and then she, as I say, met my father up here, and they were married for over 50 years and had 10 children. She was one of three daughters, and my father was an only child, so they kind of broke the mold.
Now, how big is the Getz family now? How many grandkids, kids?
Joe, I don't really, I really have to do some adding up on that, but we had a family reunion here. We had one for Mother's 90th birthday, and then which was in 1980, and then in 1990 we sort of had a 100th anniversary gathering just to get everybody together, but 100th anniversary of Mother's birth, and there were about 80 on hand. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember my last count was 60-something.
Yeah. And this, of course, is all the children and grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and a lot of spouses, a lot of in-laws there, so.
But certainly well-blessed. What are your first memories of White Lake and this whole place? What were your...
Well, I can, you know, I remember Michelinda's. Have memories of that as a small boy. We first came over here, as they say, we were at Holland until 1917, and then during the 17 and 18 were the World War I years, and I don't really have much of any recollection of that, but we used to come up here in the 1920s by train and boat from Moline. We'd take the Rock Island Railroad to Chicago in the afternoon, and then we'd take the overnight Goodrich steamer over to, sometimes to Holland, and spend some time at Lakewood Farm in July and come on up here in August. And I remember Michelinda when I was young, and the big beach we had at that time, and canoeing off the beach, and then there were two Bryant boys here, John and Dick Bryant from Grand Rapids, whose family bought a cottage here in the middle 20s, and we used to in the cottage they bought, there was an old sail in the woodshed, and we rigged that up on this old rowboat out in front. It didn't have any keel or centerboard, so we'd sail downwind and row it back at that time, and And then there was a man here who had one of the cottages just off the association, which my sister Cicely now owns, Cicely Kane. And a man named Leon Clausen, who was with John Deere in Moline, the farm equipment manufacturer. And he was a great sailor and had a sailboat, one of the early sailboats, one of the early sailboats at the Yacht Club. I say early in the 1920s when your grandfather, Clarence Pitkin, was helping to reorganize the Yacht Club and get it going again. And Mr. Clausen used to take me sailing with him down there in 1926, the summer I was 11 years old. And I have spent a great part of my summers around the Yacht Club ever since. I was in the second sailing school class in 1927. And then sailed there ever since, went on to be a sailing school instructor in 1933. And to the best of my knowledge, and from your grandfather's old history of the sailing school, I had the largest single class that any instructor ever had. I was the only instructor there. there were only single instructors up till that time, and then I think after that year, they had two or three instructors each summer. Yeah.
Okay. Can you remember some of the names that were in that 1927 class?
Oh, sure, I do. There were the two Runyon brothers from Sylvan Beach, Bud and Joe Runyon. George Quimby, who later went on to become one of the most famous anthropologists in the country. He lives out in Seattle, is one of the leading experts on the North American Indian. George and I are still in touch with each other. Sonny Seckel, Albert Seckel, whose family had a cottage at Sylvan Beach at that time. Jim Lewis from the Frank Lewis family. A young man named Bob West, whose father was the golf pro at the golf club at that time. And, Jerome Kipley was another one. Those are the ones I think of right offhand.
Just
There were the two Bryant brothers from Michelinda here, too, John and Dick Bryant.
Okay. Just a little flashback there. Do you remember much about the First World War? Do you have any memories?
I don't have great memories of the First World War, no. I don't. By the time I was born in 1915, and the war was over in 1918, so I have
nothing.
I remember at that time we frequently had prunes for breakfast at home, and you used to save your prune pits. They were collected for supposedly something for gas masks. I have a vague recollection of that, and I've heard others refer to that in years gone by.
Did your family lose any friends from around here during the First World War?
That I don't really remember.
Yeah. Yeah. Those are kind of unfair questions. When you were teaching the sailing school, you said that you were the only teacher and you had a rather big class. How big was the class that you had?
I had about 35, as I recall. And then I had an unusual thing. I had a class of six young married women who decided they'd like to learn how to sail and approached Jack Guerin and Locher Chittenden were the sailing school supervisors at that time. And I had Peg Van Deventer and Harriet Pearson, who were both still around Sylvan Beach. This was 1933. This was 60 years ago.
Wow.
And Martha Hartman, Dodden Applegate's mother, and Locher Chittenden's wife. I should remember her name. But anyway, I had this class of young marrieds, and they were excellent students and really worked hard at learning to sail. You know, they were all in their 20s or more, and I suppose all of them in their 20s, and they were very serious about learning to sail, more so than some of the, you know, typical students who were 12, 13, 14 around there.
Yeah, put in their time.
Yeah.
What type of boat did you teach on?
We taught in a seaboat, a gaff rig seaboat. I had an old one. It had originally belonged to Milton Pillinger, one of the Pillinger family. He lived right down there where around where your father and mother are now, and it was one of the original sea boats that brought in here, I think, and they were brought in 1927, I'm quite sure. There were four or five or six of them bought at that time, and this one was originally named the Hellbar, H-E-L-B-A-R, after Helen and Barbara Pillinger, his wife and his daughter, and I bought it from him in 1930, I think it was.
Who made the Gaffray Seaboats?
Palmer Boat Company at Fontana, Wisconsin, and as I remember at the time, you bought a Gaffray Seaboat, a 20-foot seaboat, complete with sail, for $610. I bought it from him used in 1930 for 30 or 31 for $200.
Now, how did you buy the seaboats back then? When you bought a new one, what did you go over to see Mr. Palmer, or did you?
I was never in on the purchase of a new one, so I'm not sure about that, but I remember a picture from in one of the White Lake Yacht Club news that your grandfather edited of A-boats arriving on a railroad car. And I don't know when they bought this original fleet of gaff rig seaboats, five or six of them. I don't know whether they, I would imagine they probably were shipped over by rail. You know, there wasn't much in highway transportation in 1927. I think the first year we drove up here from Moline, that my father drove us up here, was 1928 or 9. And we left in the early hours of darkness, morning hours when it was still dark in Moline, and it was after dark when we got here, because at that time it was two-lane highway all the way, and you went right through the middle of every town.
What type of car did your dad drive you?
Yeah, at that time it was a 7-passenger Studebaker touring car.
Oh my God.
You know, with jump seats and everything, you know. We had a big family. I think some of the time it took, there was always a baby in the family, had to stop and heat up a bottle along the way someplace. But
your family? Yeah. Imagine there was. Oh, God. You mentioned also that you took the boat up here at times. Which ships did you take up here? Do you remember riding on the Carolina?
Which ship? Oh, I think in our early days, I said, sometimes we went to Holland and went to Lakewood Farm down there, my uncle's farm first. And there used to be a city of Grand Rapids that we took in the Alabama, and I probably the Carolina, but...
Did you disembark at the arcade?
When we came up here, there used to be a dock, and I don't know that we ever got out of there. There used to be one at Lakeside. Did you know that?
Yeah,
right in front of where the Mole's house is over there now.
Okay.
There was a dock there, and there was a Michelinda, and we have some old historical stuff. I don't have it up here. I have it at home, but there was a Michelinda Beach Dock Company, and. That helped finance that over there, but I think I don't know how many years that lasted. It was kind of a losing proposition. I think the assessments annually to keep it up finally got the best of them, and they abandoned it. But I remember well when the Carolina was still coming in to the arcade at Sylvan Beach, and I remember Leonard Bloomdahl out there, big strapping guy with leather gloves on, handling the lines out there, and I thought he had one of the greatest jobs in the world at that time. Yeah.
Back when
Edna's family, the Kern family, was running the arcade and the grocery store and all down there.
Right. Right. Just back to sailing school for a second. If I were a student in your class, how many classes would you take me out in a week and teach in?
We went out, as I recall, about three times a week, and Joe, at that time, it was a lot different. Families came and stayed for the summer, and when you had students for the summer, you usually had them for all of July and August. I mean, you didn't have these 2 and 3 week periods that they do. And there was only one course then. There wasn't any elementary and intermediate and advanced or introduction to sailing or anything like that. I had the same students all summer, and pretty generally speaking, and there was just one level of instruction. There weren't the, what do they got, two, three or four different levels now, yeah.
Wait, did you have a textbook or anything?
Yeah, oh yes. There were Alvin Youngquist had gotten involved in it by the time I was teaching, and there was a manual to teach from, and some drawings of various rigs. Another thing we taught at that time that was very much a part of were splicing lines. You know, with the new braided line and everything, you don't do that anymore. But all the lines at that time were all old three-strand braided lines, and three-strand laid-up lines, Manila.
And, remember those?
And so you taught splicing as part of the deal at that time too.
Sure. Did you have like one class a week inside, or do you remember?
As I recall, we kind of aimed at that, but we sort of played it by ear as to what the weather was. If there was too much wind or not enough wind or raining or something, then we had an inside class. That was pretty much at the discretion of the instructor at that time. Yeah.
Did you ever fail any students? Did you ever fail any students? You don't have to name them if you did. I just wondered as an old teacher whether you failed.
Yes, I did.
You did. And why?
Two.
Why would you fail them?
Because they just never learned to sail.
Yeah.
One of them was much too young. He had two older brothers in the class, and we really at that time we didn't take anybody unless they were going to be at least 12 years of age, and we're going to be 12 by that summer. For instance, when I went in 1927, why I was 11 at the beginning of the summer, and I reached my 12th birthday on August 21st, and so that was sort of the criteria for it at that time. This one young boy I failed was really too young to go, or maybe I was too old to teach him, but maybe it wasn't his fault. But anyway, the only reason he was in the class was because his father wanted him in there with his two older brothers, and I was persuaded to take him, but he just he didn't soak it up very well. I don't think he had his mind on it.
Yeah.
And then I had one girl in the class who just never caught on. Much as I tried, I gave her a lot of individual attention.
Yeah, well, there are times, I failed to myself through the years. They just never learned, so you couldn't do anything.
That's right.
I felt horrible. What's going on that you've seen that why the people don't stay for the whole summer? That things have changed. Why?
Because it's too easy to. I think because it's too easy to do other things, to go traveling today, and with the highways and such. We used to come over here. My mother would pack steamer trunks, and just pack up for the summer over here. And back in the late 20s and early 30s, you ordered canned goods shipped over from. Montgomery Ward or Sears Roebuck in Chicago. They used to make out orders and kind of ship over the non-perishable summer supplies would come from then. I mean, there weren't good roads to drive. There weren't any supermarkets at that time or anything. We used to have here at Michelin, and I know, of course, they did at Sylvan, too. Why, there was a woman with a Mrs. Siebert with a horse-drawn wagon. She and her husband came around with vegetables and perishables, that sort of thing. And I also remember that our caretaker here used to cut ice in Duck Lake, and I'm sure you had the same thing down there at Sylvan. He cut ice at Duck Lake, and we had an ice house here, and it was all packed in sawdust, and there was no automatic refrigeration at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know just what year the automatic refrigeration came in, but I would believe it was probably late 40s or late 30s, something like that, I would think.
During this period that you were teaching and doing this, the Great Depression was on. Do you have any memories of that?
Oh, I remember a lot of discussion about it. We were very fortunate that while we were constantly reminded that it was on, and I'm sure my father and mother lived very carefully, and our family business at home was terrible at the time. It's a business of building quite large and fairly expensive machinery. Why the depression was very rough on our family business. But as a as a teenager, a child and teenager through that period, why, a young person, I should say, I wasn't a child, why, we lived very frugally. I mean, there wasn't a lot of money spent on extraneous things, but we lived a very comfortable life, and we came up here in the summertime. Mm-hmm. So,
perhaps being young too, you really wasn't as much
aware of it. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. For that.
I was hearing about it, though. I certainly don't, I wasn't immune to it and not unaware of it. I certainly.
What were the causes of the Great Depression?
I don't know. That would be one. That'd be another subject. I think it was.
Old table.
Yeah, it was due to a lot of things. I think people kind of went crazy thinking they could make millions in the stock market, and they just. There were just a lot of things that brought it on. It wasn't just the Great Depression. Unique to the United States. It was sort of a worldwide thing. A lot of historians have blamed it on some of the tariff laws and the protectionist laws that went on at that time. Joe, you ought to get to somebody who's more of a student of long-time economic student than I am to really analyze what caused the Great Depression. My very conservative father and a lot of others like him were sure it was Franklin D. Roosevelt's fault, but
of course that was 29 and he didn't come in until
32.
Yeah.
and all the Democrats were sure it was Herbert Hoover's fault, so
he was actually a very, very great man who saved most of Europe after the First World War. He was great
in a lot of ways, and he had his faults as a president, I gather, as every president has them.
Well, there's no textbook for the job, so. Back to the yacht club, the junior yacht club. Were you involved in the junior yacht club?
I was involved in that. Was one of the original members of the junior yacht club. Yeah.
Members. Can you tell us how it got going?
I somebody decided, and slightly older juniors than I was at the time, the Manny brothers, Neil's older brothers, Harvey and Chick Manny, were very active in the club, and. Harry Pillinger was, of course. The Pillingers were deep in it at that time, and I'm not sure. There were people from Sylvan Beach and such, and Jim Lewis and the Meegan brothers from down at the Irish Village, and father of the current Meegan boys who are here, of Gray and Charlie, and. There were just a group of young people on the club who were sailing at that time, and I'm not sure who was the instigator in forming a junior yacht club, but if you look at the pictures of junior commodores on the wall, why, I was, I don't know, maybe the fourth or fifth one, I think, something like that. Or,
did you guys write the bylaws and everything written by you fellows?
That I don't, I can't say I recall that, who wrote Junior Yacht Club bylaws or anything. I remember we used to have periodic meetings, but I'm not even sure what went on there. Yeah, how often they occurred.
Were they held at night at the
yes,
time like that?
Usually in the evening. And there used to be junior yacht club dances in the middle of the week at back at some period there. I don't know.
How did you get there when you were young from over here?
you walked or you rode a bicycle and thought nothing of it at that time. And then by 1931 I had acquired a Model T Ford that I drove up here. And it didn't run well enough for me to drive it home. I sold that to the O'Connell brothers, as I recall. But anyway, there was a lot of walking and bicycle riding done. Back when I was growing up here at Michelinda in the 1920s, we didn't get any mail delivery at Michelinda. Our post office was Lakeside Inn. And a man named Glenn Talent ran it at that time. And all the Michelinda mail was delivered down there, and we used to walk down. Usually one or two of us kind of had a little franchise for that, and we'd get paid 50 cents a week by each cottage owner to go down, and we'd go down and bring up most of the mail for the association. And we walked down and walked back with it. It just We walked right down past the Michelinda Beach Lodge here, which at that time, I don't know whether you know, originally was the Michelinda Beach Tavern. And when Prohibition was repealed in about 1933, they had so many people driving in there to look for a drink, they changed the name of it to the Michelinda Beach Lodge. A man named Duttenhofer ran it at that time. You've heard that name,
yeah,
I'm sure.
Yeah.
I think the Duttenhofers, one or more of them, had a cottage at Sylvan Beach.
You mentioned Prohibition. Do you have any memories of Prohibition? Did you fellas, when you were young, did you drink it all up here?
Yes.
Well,
just kind of on the edge of it. Well, I'll tell you, one time I can remember just about the time Prohibition was repealed. George Quimby and Joe Runyon. George had, and I think maybe the Runyons, who were a little older than I was, had been in it before, but we drove out to a farm back of Montague. There was a man named Henderson out there. I don't know whether I should be quoted on this, but he was a black man with a white wife, and he had a farm out back of Montague, and he was a bootlegger out there. And we drove out, and the procedure was that you stayed in the car, and he came out to the car with a lantern to look you over, and if he knew somebody in there, why, he disappeared with a spade and a gunny sack and went out. He had this stuff buried out around his acreage out there. And I can remember we bought some home brew from him, and it had yeast about half an inch thick in the bottom of the bottles. We bought home brew and some elderberry wine. And I think that was the first time with that stuff that I over-imbibed. We were up here early before my parents were here, had driven up, over-imbibed, and I can remember being very ill afterwards. But other than that, I don't remember too much.
But that's fascinating.
Yeah.
And
at home in Moline, we knew a few places where we could pick up a little illicit liquor, so it was available, just like today, I suppose, on drugs and such, which I'm glad to say I've never had any involvement with. But there were places that if you wanted it, you knew where to get it.
Yeah.
Of course, I'd gotten the age. You see, when Prohibition was repealed, that was 1933. I think I was 18 years old then, and so I just didn't. I was aware it was illegal to drink for maybe a year or two before it was repealed. Yeah.
What did they change the drinking age to then?
I don't remember. I don't remember that. Yeah.
What do you think about Prohibition? Just as was it worth it?
I think that everybody was cheating on it. I mean, it just was such an unpopular thing that I've always said, and I had quite an involvement in Moline for a number of years in politics. Why? There are three things you can't stop people from doing, and that's drinking and gambling and prostitution. People are going to do it regardless of how.
Jefferson felt that way too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Laws about morals.
Yeah.
Because
everybody.
That's right. It's like the drug.
I can remember my father and mother during Prohibition. I didn't ever see them do much drinking, but my father had a couple of bottles hidden in a wardrobe at home, I remember, and when very good friends came, and my mother's sister was never married, one of mother's sisters who never married and taught at Smith College for 35 years, why, when she'd come home, they'd get out a bottle and have a little drink because my grandparents didn't approve of it, so Aunt Dot had come over to our house to have a little snifter.
Nip there.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Do you remember, just speaking of Prohibition, do you remember any gangsters around here when
no.
you grew up and you see
never.
Anybody driving through?
Never.
I forget where they were, but it's
no.
kind of been down.
Never knew or heard a thing about that.
You mentioned that you were in politics. Can you tell us about what you
Well, did? I was a school board member in Moline for a number of years and then was on the city council there as an alderman. And then I became Republican county chairman of our county, and was involved in that for 8 years, and then went on the state committee representing. I was a state committeeman representing our congressional district.
And then you went on farther, didn't you?
Well, no, that was the end. That was the end of that. I was county chairman for 8 years and state committeeman for 12 years. During that time, I was a delegate to a national convention at one time. I helped nominate Barry Goldwater in 1964, which kind of labels me as to the conservative bent of my politics.
Well, I guess he turned out to be right in many things, mm-hmm. if we look back now. Yeah. You know, I think he was probably right in a lot of things. Do you have any memories of the maids around, that the maids that used to come up to you? Remember?
Oh, sure. We didn't ever bring maids up with us because we were either at my grandfather's cottage down here, my grandparents' cottage, and they had maids down there. They had a cook and a maid that used to come up with them. And quite a few of the families here at Michelinda had maids, and we have a back room in this cottage. My father and mother acquired this cottage as an overflow for our big family in 1954. And so during our years around here, there's never been a maid in the place, but there's a room off the kitchen that I'm sure was the maid's room. And
were they mainly black or white?
Well, most of them. There were a few black ones up here. My great grandmother, who spent her winters in Florida, she had a black maid with her for years and years up here. And there were a few others, but the maids that I remember around here were mainly white.
Okay, maybe I have to stop.
On Sylvan Beach, I remember seeing them walking around there and taking care of small children and such. I started when I was in sailing school, and I really was around the Yacht Club first in 1926 and then in sailing school in 27. And I met Ed Middleton from Sylvan Beach, and Sonny Seckel, who was in my Albert Seckel Jr., who was in my sailing school class, and I started spending more time at Sylvan Beach than I did at Michelinda, and by 1928, around in there. So I was around Sylvan Beach a great deal with good friends from the young friends from the Yacht Club contemporaries.
Can you tell us, name some of the peers of yours from Sylvan
Beach? From Sylvan Beach?
Yeah.
Well, again, I mentioned Ed Middleton and Albert Seckel, who I still hear of now and then. He's still, that cottage, they were on the White Lake side up there, all around where the Schaefers are and the that area up there. But Bill Hartz, of course, was a friend of mine from over there. And the Runyon brothers, and then slightly older fellows I knew over there were Bill and Phil Vandeventer and Bob McDowell, Peg Vandeventer's brother, and Art Rooney, Dick Tenner. There were quite a group there at that time.
What were some of the girls that you remember?
Well, Dorothy Middleton, Lucy Lee McDonald, who was Lucy Lee Jackman, you know, Harry Jackman's first wife, and Jeannie Murdoch, and Fifi Murdoch, sure, and and Liz Ehlers, I knew she was one of the Bunnell family and knew those girls, so.
What did you do? Did you date at all when you were younger?
Oh, sure, sure.
What did you do on an average date?
You want to order, Yacht Club dances were always a big thing. They had, as I say, junior dances the middle of the week, and then there was always a dance Saturday night. There wasn't a dinner there at that time, but they had a band and dancing over there, and that was a great place to go. And they had movies at the Playhouse in Whitehall at that time. You'd go to the movies and beach parties sometimes, and so
just the general things that we
sure
do the same,
sure.
same things. That's, do you remember Frank Adams very well at all?
I remember seeing him. I knew what he looked like, and he was a very, very kind man, and he always very friendly. But I do not remember him well. I remember Lorna, his wife, better than I do Frank. I guess she's still down in White Lake, isn't she?
Yeah, I taped her a couple of weeks.
Did you?
A couple of weeks ago, about a couple of months ago, actually.
How is she? Is she?
She's slowing down a little. She says. Yeah. She's 93, I think.
Is she 93?
Yeah. So, yeah. But she was. You know,
She's. I'll. In another 2 weeks, I'll be 78. She was. So she was 15 years older than I was at the time. That's when you're young. That's a big gap.
Oh yeah, years. Yeah. A big gap. Mm-hmm. When you're young. That's very true. Just to go back for a second, on the Junior Yacht Club, in the Junior Yacht Club, what were the members of the flag lines? Are the titles the same still? Did you have rear
Commodore, Vice Commodore, and Rear Commodore, yeah, and then there was
a fleet captain?
And then I don't remember a fleet captain in the Junior Yacht Club, but of course there were the three Commodores, and a secretary and a treasurer, yeah.
Do you remember much about the Sylvan Beach Hotel? You were saying that you...
I remember its existence, and there were some friends of Bill Hartz's, Bob Wolf, and then the Wolfs, they were friends of Bill Hartz's parents, used to come and stay there, the Wolf family, Bob Wolf, and then Bob Barr's family originally came to the old Sylvan Beach Hotel. Bob, who married Mim, you know, married Mim Bartlett Butterfield. But... I remember the existence of the hotel, but I don't remember really anything about it. And remember hearing one that, what did it do? Did it burn or was it torn down? Burned, didn't it, as I recall? Yeah.
Were you involved, just wondering on this, were you involved in the car wreck with Bill Hartz and Jeannie Schmidt and Fifi?
No, I was not.
Okay, you weren't in the car wreck. Okay, during your years, going back to when you first were here, do you have any memories of the worst storm? Can you remember in particular any day that was really bad or storm?
Storm? I remember the storm I really remember is the 1937 Mackinac race when I don't know how many boats started then. I suppose there were 40 to 45 and only seven of them finished that year. And I had gotten deeply into sailing and always hoped that I'd sail a Mackinac race, but when that storm came up, it was a hard blow out of the northwest, and I think six or seven boats came in here to White Lake, and there was a great big sloop named the Marchioness. It was owned by a man named Norman Marsh. Marchioness was the name of the boat, owned by a man named Norman Marsh, and he was quite well known in Chicago. He was a cartoonist who did a cartoon named Dan Dunn Detective at that time, sort of a forerunner of Dick Tracy. And they tried to come into the piers and the wind blew them off below, and we still had the Coast Guard station here at that time. And the Coast Guard went out on a little open surf boat. It wasn't a self-righting thing or anything like that. And they went out and got a line on the bow of the Marchioness, and Marchioness had its motor going, but it wasn't powerful enough to work it against the wind, and they pulled them up to where they could get them into the channel. And I remember a lot of us standing out on the piers and cheering as the Marchioness finally got inside the piers. It was a very heroic thing by the Coast Guard. And
yeah, that amazes me how they used to go out in those boats that wouldn't break themselves.
Yeah.
Just the strength and the courage of those men must have been.
I don't know what the last year of the Coast Guard station was, but they were still going in 1937. But that Mackinac in 1937, up to that point, was considered the second roughest Mackinac in history. And then I started sailing Mackinac races in 1939. I worked in Chicago for our company for a few years. And we had another one in 1970 a storm that ranked up with those two earlier ones, they said.
Oh, okay. Well, what was the first one? The first worst one was the 37?
No, the worst one was back in about 1911, I think, as I recall it was. And they had a rouser at that time, and then this 1937 was considered one of the second greatest storms in Mackinac history. And then I was in one in 1970 that was considered a third one to rank with those two earlier ones.
Was there any loss of life?
Nope. Good. I don't think there's ever been a loss of life in the Mackinac race.
Oh, wow.
What were some of the more, in your memory of all the years up here, what you would call characters, the notable characters that...
Well, of course, old Ed Wilson was a notable character who lived down in the desert down there. Have you heard of Ed Wilson?
No, I haven't.
He was kind of a carpenter. As you come around, well, it's the house as you go up Starboard Drive where the Hartzes live and Diana Mannon and those condominiums up there. That small house just to the right as you go up that drive. That was Ed Wilson's house. And he was kind of a carpenter and boat builder around here. And he owned a lot of that land out in the desert. That was all, that's what we used to call that area between Hairpin Curve and Sylvan Beach was the desert out there. And there were only a few houses out there. And practically nothing at that time.
No foliage?
No. That's all been developed since I was first aware of it in the late 20s. And Ed Wilson was a character. There used to be another man I'm sure you've probably heard about, Bill Allen, who was the crossing guard down there at Sylvan Beach between the tennis courts and the arcade down there. And he used to be down there in uniform. He was reputed to be a retired Chicago policeman, and he also was reputed to be part Indian. He had kind of a very ruddy face, and his hair always looked, we all were sure that he plastered it down with black shoe polish every day. But he was a very genial guy. But boy, at that time, when the arcade was there, and of course the tennis courts were always there, there was a stop sign there, and you came to a complete stop, and Bill Allen was out there during the day controlling traffic at that time.
Do you know approximately the years of that?
Well, certainly my years around Sylvan were the late 20s and into the 30s and to the middle 30s. Some Sylvan Beach residents of approximately my age, late 70s, would have to tell you how many years Bill Allen was around.
Was there enough traffic to merit?
Apparently there was. Apparently there was, late 20s, during the 30s. Yeah, I don't know how many years, but everybody knew him. He was a very genial sort of guy, but he also was, he lived in a house over on Michelinda Road, but he was a character, like Ed Wilson, and
you mentioned a name, just some of the, George Runyon, you said?
Bud and Joe Runyon.
One of those was a real character.
Bud was the character, yeah. He's the one who finally, he loved to tie one on in the evenings, and he just, probably something that shouldn't be talked about publicly, but he loved tie one on. He got in a bad automobile accident, was paralyzed for the rest of his life, I guess. And then Joe, during World War II, was in, I think, Navy Air Force, and was walking down through an airplane, and accidentally or unexpectedly the bomb bay doors opened up, and he, I think, over Long Island Sound dropped to his death. Yeah, but they were very well known characters around young men around Sylvan Beach.
Do you remember any more characters, the people that?
I'll tell you, Bill Vandeventer was a character.
Tell us something about Bill.
Oh, Bill Vandeventer and Phil, his brother, were two of the finest men I ever knew, and they were great tennis players, I guess, great golfers too. But where the Wob Club now stands used to be an open field there, and every Sunday afternoon there was a softball game down there. And Bill Vandeventer and Phil. Bill especially were superb athletes in almost anything they did. And Bill was the one person I know used to stand up there at bat with a stogie in his mouth, a cigar in his mouth, and hit one of those big soft kitten balls, a 16-inch softball, over the road and into White Lake from back there at the base of the hill coming down there, right behind the tennis court backstop is where.
Right.
That was the field where there was a softball game, and they were more fun because everybody was kidding everybody else. Nobody took them awfully seriously. They played hard, but...
So you were there often?
Oh, sure. I don't know how many years, but we just looked forward to that. That was the Sunday afternoon activity for a couple hours at softball game there. And But, they were a couple of great guys. Bob McDowell, Peggy Van Deventer's brother, was another, he was a delightful guy. He was always in the softball game. There was a great tennis rivalry between the Van Deventers and the Runyons. There was another man lived, young man lived right up on the hill as you, to the right as you go up from the arcade there, the first cottage on the White Lakeside, whose name was Art Rooney, and I don't know if you've heard that name.
Yeah,
Art Rooney, and another one named Dick Tenner. And anyway, their tennis was, I was never a tennis player, but their tennis was a lot of fun to watch. It was, they had a great time doing it, a lot of fun.
I heard about some of those games. I guess they were really,
they really
had
were.
Fun doing it too,
yeah.
Plus good tennis, I gather.
Yeah.
So that was good. What's the most famous person that you ever met up at White Lake or saw here at White Lake?
Oh, goodness.
There's probably a few, maybe, yeah.
I don't know. We were pretty impressed with Mr. Uline and Mr. Falk, who used to come over in their yachts, the Atlantic and the Seaforth, from Milwaukee. Yeah, I'm sure you've heard of those. These big yachts. The Atlantic was a big three-masted schooner, about 125 feet long, and the Seaforth was that bigger. That was owned by Herman Falk, a Milwaukee industrialist, and I don't know. I don't know whether they were important or not, but they sure had a lot of money, and at that age looked important to us. And, you know, that was during the Depression years. Mr. Eline was the chairman of the Schlitz Brewery, and they were very nice men. They used to come into the yacht club and in their tenders in there for one thing or another, and were always very cordial. And Mr. Eline took us all sailing one time on his boat, but one Sunday afternoon, but... And I used to, have you got anything on the Sedonis or no?
Well, that's my next question, was Joe Sedoni. Do you have any?
Well, Joe and Art got into sailing A-boats with being instructed by Jack DeFrega, who was with him, and a wonderful man. And Jack had come up from Spring Lake and lived over at the Sedonis Valley of the Pines. And they got one of the A-boats, Nemesis. I don't know, I wrote a little story of the A-boats that was in the main sheet in the last 4 or 5 years, kind of the history of A-boat racing here. I was here over that length of time, and which spanned a comparatively brief period from about 1927 to 1935, but we had 10 of them on the lake at one time. And your father was an investor in one of them, Miss Whitehall, or your grandfather, I mean, was an investor in one of them, Miss Whitehall. But anyway, I sailed with the Sedonis and used to get over, and we great stories about Professor and Mrs. Sedoni. They were a delightful pair, and he supposedly made his living as a psychic, you know, and an advisor to famous people, and they just were two very nice people, and I knew Joe and Art quite well, and... So,
did you ever see any psychic demonstration or anything ever happen?
No, I didn't. But there were some very well-known people who used to come over to visit Mr. Sedoni, Professor Sedoni, at the Valley of the Pines. One of his steady clients was Wayne King, the band leader, who the Waltz King, and who was a fixture in music for a number of years. Very fine man. And I didn't ever meet him. I saw him with the Sedonis a couple of times. But anyway, there was a aura of mystery about him, you know, but Mr. Sedoni was just delightful. They used to come over for all the Saturday night dances, and I think probably Joe and Art were both Commodores at one time, They worked on the sailing school for a year or two, Joe and Art and Jack DeFrega, but I don't think that was a very long duration.
Do you have any memories of Jack DeFrega? Anything?
Oh, yes. He had a delightful person and an excellent sailor, and he also was a great artist. You've probably seen these maps of White Lake. He's done personalized maps of White Lake. We've got one of them in here. And... he was a superb sailor and just a great guy, and I don't know much about Jack. He had a sister and brother-in-law down at Spring Lake, and I don't know a great deal about his background, but he came up here and lived with the Sidonis up here, and I think Joe or Art Sidoni, of course, who's a survivor of that family, I'm not sure that he would like me saying this, but he taught Joe and Art to sail, and Joe and Art were very quick learners, but Jack was kind of the sailing master on the boat, the tactician and such, when I was sailing on the A-boat with him.
And Jack had kind of called the shots.
That's right, okay. Yes.
Okay. Going back for a second, you mentioned the Mr. Hulein.
Eline. It was E-U-H-L-I-E-N. E-U-H-L-I-E-N. And he was Irwin C. Eline, but he was known as Ike Eline, I think, by his contemporaries and associates. Handsome, delightful man.
Is it any truth to the story that the yacht club got beer during the Second World War? He would bring it over on his yacht.
Well, he couldn't have because his yacht went into government service.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And I think Jack DeFraga served on the Atlantic. It was a patrol vessel, was what it was along the Atlantic coast. It wasn't anything that would ever go into combat. It was
ship in the army type of thing.
Yeah. If they got beer during if they got beer during World War II from Mr. Eline, it's probably he arranged with his local distributor for some special treatment of the yacht club, would be my guess, because he couldn't have brought it over on his boat because his boat was out in the Atlantic Ocean at that time.
Fighting submarines.
Yeah.
Because I remember when we were growing up at the yacht club, they only served Schlitz beer, and the old tale was that's because Joe Schlitz or whatever, you know.
Ike Eline. I think he was a good friend of your grandfather's, and he was a nice guy. But those two boats used to come over. They'd invite guests for the weekend, you know, and those two boats would come across the lake overnight on Friday night from Milwaukee and be anchored off the yacht club out there. I don't know that it was every weekend, but we saw them fairly frequently during the summer, and they'd come over on Friday night and go back again Sunday afternoon, and so everybody was home for the office on Monday morning. But,
approximately what size was that?
Well, the Atlantic, I know, was 125 feet, and I think that the Seaforth was, that, as I say, was a three-masted schooner, and the Seaforth, which was purely a power yacht, a very handsome power yacht in its day, why, I think it was roughly the same length.
Okay. Do you remember a man by the name of Al Pack?
Sure. The Al Pack estate was up where Hooker is now up there. Hooker bought his land. As I recall hearing, he was head of Great Lakes Steel in Detroit. And he had a big power yacht and later a big sailing yacht. And I saw him a few times. I never knew Al Pack. There were great stories that what a goer he was, how he worked like hell in Detroit all week and partied just as hard over here all weekend, but I can't vouch for the authenticity of of any of those stories. But
yeah, he's one of those names that you pop
up.
You can't anything to, but that was you gave me the most that I've heard so far, and the place that he ran and worked at. We're getting near the Second World War. What did you serve during the Second World War?
No, I did not. We were, I was involved, one of our two companies at home had made, in fact, Moline Forge, which is an offshoot of the older company, Williams White, was really formed at making shell forgings, 75 millimeter shell forgings for Deering Company during World War I. And so we had one of the early educational orders before the United States was in World War II. Our government was making shells for the French and the British. And we having, our company having made them, I wasn't there at the time, I was just an infant then, but having made them during World War I, we had one of the, were on the list and had one of the early educational orders and contracts during, in the early days of World War II, before we were actually in there. We were forging shells in the spring of 41 before Pearl Harbor in December of 41. And we had a very elderly shop superintendent at that time, and I was put in a Moline Forge by my father and my uncle to understudy him, and he folded up very rapidly. So I was plant superintendent out there in the shop before Pearl Harbor, and we were deep in making shell forgings and also a lot of forgings for military trucks for General Motors truck and coach. And that kept me out of the service. I was put in 1A a couple of times, and then it was decided by the ordnance department that I was more valuable in the shop than I was in uniform. And so while I worked harder than I'd ever worked in my life during those years, why I spent every night at home in my own bed. So I was very fortunate. My brother John was in service, and Tom's 12 years younger than I am. Tom was in service during the Korean War, but John was in the Army for my brother John for about 5 years.
Wow. Where did he serve? Did he serve over what branch?
Well, he served mainly out in the Pacific. He was in an armored tank battalion, and they took him to Hawaii and converted them to a flame tank battalion, and he was out in the South Pacific in the
He saw the worst of the worst, didn't he?
He saw the worst of the worst, yeah.
That was rough.
He ended up on Okinawa and later in Korea in the final days of the war.
He went to the Korean War.
He was, no, not Korean War, but the Japs had Korea, and I don't know, there was a U.S. presence in there. He was put in there for a few months after the armistice with Japan there, his battalion was, so I don't know the reasons for it. But.
Well, thank God he made it. That was certainly a rough theater, to say the least. Going back just a slight bit, do you remember any jinxes that you were in?
Yes, I was in several of them, and I don't remember them all in detail. I remember one very well. We had what was called a Floridora sextet, and a reprise, I guess you would call it, of one that had been quite famous in vaudeville many years ago. And Dot Middleton, Dot Brewer, Lucy Lee, McDonald Jackman, Jeannie Schmidt, Jeannie Murdoch Schmidt, and I think it was Bill Hartz, Ed Middleton, and I were the six participants in the Floridora Sextet. And we sang a song that I almost know the words to still, but that was a lot.
Can you sing a few?
Well, it was, I don't have much of a singing voice, but it was one where the men and the girls, the boys and the girls sang back and forth to each other, and it was, "Oh, tell me, pretty maiden, are there any more at home like you?" And then the girls would say, "There are a few, kind sir, but simple maids and proper too." Anyway, it was a back and forth thing like that.
Kind of like you say potato, I say potato.
Yeah, that. Right.
But do you remember what year that was, by the chance, approximately?
Oh, I'd have to guess it was in the early 30s sometime.
Who was doing the jinxes then? Was Frank Adams still doing the jinxes?
I don't think so, but I'm not sure who was doing it at that time.
But you were in many jinxes then?
I won't say many, but I probably was in four or five, six of them, and then later on, I don't know, back in the 70s or so, why they got a group of us old ones, Jeannie Schmidt, I think, organized it. We were in some silly act, and I don't even remember what the theme was, but after we were in it back in the 70s or so, there wasn't any demand that we'd be back the next year, so that was our last appearance.
Speaking of just in general, during all your years here, have you noticed any, what are the social differences, things that have changed, parties, for instance, are there more parties, less parties, is it more sophisticated, more social, just your insight into...
Oh, I don't know.
In White Lake in general.
I don't know. I think they're probably about the same number of parties, and I don't know that it's become much more social. We were at the large one the Duprees had the other night, and I certainly didn't see many neckties there. There was anything very, very formal about anything, but no, I think it's... I think probably there are about the same number of parties. I think it's been a delightfully low-key and friendly place around here. It's just, I marvel at how you see people 2 to 2.5 months out of the year up here and return in the spring and pick up with them like you'd left off the day or week before. I think it's just one of the friendliest, I think, populated by the friendliest, charming, most delightful people I know. They're just...
Friends stay friends.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I've had certainly wonderful friendships that I've made up here that have been some of my most prized friendships all my life.
Do you notice any other social differences or anything?
Well, certainly one thing that's gone on through the years, there's a lot more eating out with I suppose it's due to the lack of cooks and maids and the automobiles and the roads and all that sort of thing. But you certainly didn't years ago. You used to go out for supper at the Crosswinds or the Galleon or the Rooster or Lakeside Inn or something like that. Like we do. I won't say frequently, but do quite often today. Yeah.
Did your parents, when they had parties, I guess up here, they. During Prohibition, though, they couldn't drink or anything, so that was probably,
They weren't supposed to.
Yeah. I had some old film.
I got to leave you for a minute, too. I think he's a great guy, but he dresses very nicely.
Was there a difference in the, for instance, when you were growing up with SEX, sex, or with your peers and that, did you... talk about sex? Did you experiment? Was there?
Oh no, I say no.
Pretty innocent period.
That's right. Yes, it was.
Nothing wrong with that.
We weren't unaware of it, but
playing ball with the guys and running around.
Yeah, there wasn't all the emphasis on it there is today, and all the publicity on it and that sort of thing.
That's ridiculous. It's not necessary.
Amen.
Yeah, I agree. What were the roads like back then when you lived in the 20s and 30s?
Well, in the 20s and 30s, you know, they were all two-lane roads at that time, and there were some good ones and some bad ones, and of course Scenic Drive was just paved through here about the 1920s and middle 1920s, and you didn't used to be able to dry. There was no rickety. There was just it was a sand road and a rickety wooden bridge across the Duck Lake outlet, and we never got down at what's now the Gold Coast, or what they call the Gold Coast, and where the Rooster is and everything. We never got down that way.
So that was just an old sandy trail.
Sure, that's right. Yes.
Do you remember horses up here? Did people still use horses at all in the 20s?
Yes, there were some there were some horses around still in the 20s. And as I say, this family that came in here with fresh produce about 3 days a week, a Mrs. Siebert, and I think her husband was with her at times, they had a horse-drawn wagon in the early 20s, and I think it was late 20s before you started seeing trucks around.
Yeah. Well, without the roads, it would make it a little harder for those types of things.
I do not remember, Joe, when people used to... For instance, I don't recall when they used to take launches to Whitehall to go shopping up there. That was really before my active memory went into gear. There were cars. My grandparents used to get a car up here, I think, in the whole middle 20s. I say we came up in one in 1928 or 29. But we used to go. I don't remember going by boat to Whitehall for anything. I remember we used to drive up. And
often, let's say in your teenage years or the beginning of your 20s, did you go to town?
We used to go fairly frequently for that. I mean, by as I say, I had a Model T Ford up here in 1931, and a Model A soon after that, and there were others of my contemporaries who had acquired cars and or had family cars they could use. So we got around in those by, I'd say by 32, 3, around in there.
Okay. Back to the lake, who were the best sailors, female and male, that you ever saw on White Lake?
Well,
name of, I mean, you don't have to name one or two groupings.
Fifi Murdoch was an awfully good, she was an awfully good sailor. Liz Bunnell, Liz Ehlers was a good sailor. Liz was good at everything. You know, the poor gal had her polio, but she was a top notch as a kid. I can remember what a well-coordinated gal she was, and she was a good golfer, a good tennis player, and she was also an excellent sailor. Harry Pillinger was a good sailor. Alvin Youngquist was a superb one. The Sidonis were. There was a family from Grand Rapids, the Luce family, L-U-C-E. I don't know whether that name has surfaced with you, but Tom Luce and his son Charles, and they were good sailors. Sonny Seckel was a good seaboat sailor. The Manny brothers, Chick and Harv, I'm not sure who was the best. They had one of the early gaff rig seaboats up here. See, when they used to help get the Yacht Club really going, why this group, there were the Mannies and the Krugmans and the Garners and Milton Pillinger and Harold Pillinger, Harry's father. I think they had the first seaboats, and then very soon after that, the Clay family over at Sylvan and Carlisle Murdoch, Jeannie's father, Jeannie Schmidt's father, Jeannie and Fiffy's father, he bought one, and they were coming along pretty well until the Depression hit, and then that kind of put a stop to boat buying for a while, but it kept on going.
Did Palmer continue to make boats through the Depression?
I think so. I think Palmer went on through the Depression, and then, as I remember it, Mr. Palmer died, who was the head of the boat company, and he had a son-in-law who took over, whose name escapes me now, who apparently never was quite the man that Mr. Palmer was. So Mr. Palmer's superintendent or foreman, the head of his boat building activity, he left the Palmer Boat Company to start his own company, and his name was Harry Melgus. That was Buddy's father, you see. So the Melgus, Harry Melgus had his beginnings building Palmer boats at Fontana, Wisconsin, which is at the west end of Lake Geneva. And then Harry Melgus Sr., Buddy's father, moved to further on down the lake, but back away from the lake, and I understood he did this because he said he didn't want to be bothered furnishing battens and tillers and such on Saturday and Sunday. He wanted to sail himself. So he located in Zenda, Wisconsin, which you've heard of. That's where the Melgus Boat Works is now. And as I gather, they're 3 or 4 or 5 miles off the lake. I have been there once years ago. So Harry Melgus Sr. started the Melgus Boat Company then. And of course, there was always another old one, old if not older than Palmer, up at White Bear Lake up in Minnesota. That was Johnson up there, the Johnson Boat Works. And of course, they're still going and still building MCs and seaboats and E-boats. And they built these Optimus prams we have down here at the club.
Okay. Those prams, that's right.
And then there also used to be another scow builder over in Wisconsin called Jones and Laborde, and we had a couple of their last boats here on White Lake. One of them was Nemesis, the Sidonis boat, and another one was the E-boat Hope that Ed Middleton owned, but which Jack DeFraga used to sail down at Spring Lake. And those were both built by Jones and Laborde, who I believe were at Oshkosh, Wisconsin.
Just a question. When would you have to say, when would you, what period, what years would you pick that the Great Depression came to an end? What year would you remember? Was it after the Second World War, late 30s? When would you?
Well, late 30s, the Depression certainly, I think 37, 38, theoretically, it was coming to an end, but from what history I've read, it was coming to an end because of the effects of the purchasing from Europe, because of the European countries getting into World War II, starting to get into World War II. And There are a lot of conservative Republicans who feel that Franklin D. Roosevelt was bailed out by the war in Europe, which started to restore some activity, manufacturing activity, to things in this country.
What do you think of that? What do you think about the economic principles and growth? Would we have gotten out of it without the war? Is it good to be left unbridled? What are you?
I haven't any idea. I just don't know.
You've been in business for so long.
I just don't know. That's hard to tell. Of course, having been, we have certainly been what are classed as small business, and in our two companies, and one of the worst things you can have, we all feel, is for the government telling you what to do all the time.
Exactly.
And I think that's one thing that one thing wrong that Mr. Clinton is doing right now, that he's the taxation he's proposing in this new tax bill is not an incentive for small business or any business to purchase new equipment and expand their operation and such and get going. It's a hesitancy to stick your neck out on anything because you don't know what's coming.
That's true too. Everybody's up in the
air. Yeah.
What do you think about the national debt?
Well, I think it should be reduced, but I think that, you know, it's one of the easiest things in the world to talk about, but how do you do it? Because any way you do it, somebody's ox is going to be gored.
Yeah.
How are you two men getting along?
Great, thank you.
Good.
Very good.
Good.
No, you know, the big things that are causing the national debt are Medicare and Social Security and things like that, and those are sacred cows to try and touch. It's just
entitlement.
The entitlements, right? They're the biggest part of it.
Do you think that this is going to sound pretty long, but do you think the debt, for instance, in '68 we left the gold standard? Is the debt?
I think that was a mistake, leaving the gold standard. Yes, I do.
Yeah, because if you're going to go along with this, because the rest of
I'm no economist, or I can't claim to know that much about it.
I don't think anybody does. It's certainly not a science.
No, I, you know, if you develop ideas on what you're reading here, but I don't know.
Okay. Back to White Lake. Do you remember the lake going up and down?
Yes.
Do you have any theories or insight into it?
I don't know whether they're theories or not, but I think the problem of the lake going up and down, I understand why it occurs. It's because of excessive rainfall. And when we have excessive rainfall, the lake goes up. And this is just not over the lakes, but over the whole watershed for the Great Lakes.
Mississippi is recording right now.
And then when you have some dry hot summers, when you have below average rainfall, and also from what I've read, in U.S. Engineers publications and other things, that in a hot dry summer, a third of the precipitation that does come down or more even in a normal year will be lost by evaporation. I mean, just what evaporates off the lake surface. And so I understand why the lake goes up and down, and I'm sure that it always has since the beginning of time. I don't know that I understand why we lost so much beach in the middle 80s. That's something I don't understand.
So you never remembered, of course, being this high and having lost this?
Oh, I never remember the beach being any narrower than it was back. Well, of course, in 1986, when we moved all our cottages back here, the water was right at the foot of the bank, and we spent all this money down here in seawalls and groins and everything, which I think the groins do some good. I think seawalls are absolutely counterproductive, I think. But Joe, I really believe that the problem is so vast, I think it's beyond the ability of the human race to control it.
There's just too many factors.
Yeah, I honestly believe that.
Did you ever have any fires over here?
One cottage burned one time back in the about 1937 or 38.
And
they were able, it happened during the afternoon. I'm not sure I remember what the cause of the fire was, but it caught on fire during the afternoon. And with garden hoses, and they had a bucket brigade up from the lake Why, they were able to save the cottages on either side of it. The cottage that caught on fire burned to the ground.
Okay, yeah. Do you remember by any chance the old car ferry, the ferry that used to be down at the channel?
Yes, I do. Oh, sure.
Do you remember? Can you tell me about that? I can't really get too much.
I don't remember. It was just a big wooden barge that held either four or six cars, and it had an engine on it, and what it did was there was a cable all the way across the channel, and the cable came up and was around a drum. So what it did was just when you went across in one direction, it just wound up the cable, pulled itself across on that cable till it got to the other side, and then they'd let down the gates and the barrier there, and the cars would go off, and they'd put on, I think it was four cars, but I remember that very well, sure.
Do you remember the cost of what it was?
No, I do not remember what they charged, but I'll bet you it was something like 50 cents or a dollar. It certainly wasn't any more than that.
Okay. Did you used to fish around here at all?
I never was involved in, I never got involved in fishing for some reason or another. I went out a couple times salmon fishing with a friend, and it's just something I never, didn't take to. I always have loved being around the water and boats and have done it all my life, and I do remember when there was quite a fleet of commercial fishing boats right up at the channel up here.
Now, how many boats do you remember at the maximum point?
About four, I think.
About four.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they would fish.
Has anybody else remembered something different or not?
No, but I remember years ago someone telling me there were like a dozen or something, mm-hmm. You know.
I don't.
Four.
I think about four is what I remember. Yeah. And they were, I think they were the Grover brothers heads, but there were There were three or four shacks along there where they stored their nets and had racks for drying them there and such when they came in. But three or four of them is all I remember there.
Okay, and they mainly fish perch?
I think more than that. They went out in the lake and went out long distances into the lake and set nets out there. I really don't know, but I was more in perch. I think they used to get whitefish and lake trout at that time, that sort of thing.
You said you didn't fish. Do you think that, I can remember when I was growing up, that there seemed to be, you could put down a worm and catch a lot of fish, and there doesn't seem to be as much fish as there used to be. Do you have any?
I don't know.
No,
yeah. My own, from my really kind of casual observation, it seems to me that as far as White Lake is concerned, that people who are experts and work at it all the time and know how to fish go out and catch fish pretty regularly and know where to go and how deep to fish and what bait to use and all that sort of thing. The dyed-in-the-wool fishermen
still
pretty consistently catch fish, but the person who goes out just on a casual basis maybe fishes three or four times a year. Doesn't it? I don't think they had more luck 50 or 60 years ago than they do today.
It's kind of like making money. Those who make it hurt the ones.
I think it's a matter of know-how and expertise and
skill.
But no, I've been sailing all my life, and I've done a lot of sailing other than White Lake, Mackinac races and Bermuda races and that sort of thing. And one question people always, who don't know anything about it, there are a couple of questions they always ask you, and one is, do you do a lot of fishing along the way when you're sailing long distance races? They envision you trolling as you're going sailing. And the other thing is, when you go on long distance races, do you anchor at night? That's
another one of
common question, yeah.
Yeah. Of course we anchor all night, I'm sure. We were talking when I first came about Carmigaren. Would you tell us your memories of Carmigaren?
Well, I just remember she was a very attractive, charming person. As we mentioned here, she was probably 50. If she died at 93, and I'll be 78 here in another couple of weeks, why, she was about 15 years older, so she wasn't a close friend or anything, but I remember as a very charming person, delightful person, and I remember she did have this shop. I don't even remember what all she sold in the shop. One of the older Sylvan Beechers, I'll bet you, like Jeannie Schmidt, would probably be a great source. I read in that article that her niece wrote to, that letter that her niece wrote to Courtney, Minerva wrote to Courtney, that she She had that shop down at the arcade for a year or two. But it used to be at the old Guerin, behind the old Guerin cottage, which is on that point just that sticks out southeast of your family cottage there.
Okay.
I remember there was a couple there, I think that house, the Guerin house, burned down, as I recall, and there was a couple built quite a modern house in there, I think, whether they built it or not. Ralph and Audrey Jones lived there at one time.
Yeah.
You know that house.
Yeah.
It's on that point.
The point, yes.
Yeah.
And that had burned that.
And that was the Guerin house there.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
And then
that burned down.
And that burned down, the original Guerin cottage there, and then behind it was a, she had some sort of a shop in there, Valhalla shop it was called. That was in that letter that Minerva, her niece, wrote to Courtney.
Right.
But she was a charming gal, but I do remember, gee, it was a big thing to go to, early Pirates Balls, to the Pirates Ball, and, but I can remember that nearly everybody was in pirate costume, and there weren't various other types of costumes like one of the last Pirates Ball. I haven't been to one for years, but Carmi, as I mentioned earlier, did used to import from some costume company a whole bunch of pirates costumes, which she rented out to people over here for the Pirates Ball weekend. Yeah,
I'll be darned.
And that was always Labor Day weekend.
Labor Day.
Yeah, it was always the Saturday of Labor Day weekend then.
Did you, the first years, you had the Grand March and everything?
Oh, sure they did, yeah.
What time was the Grand March?
That I can't
midnight.
Really. I think midnight probably, but I'm not sure. And they used to, incidentally, at the Pirates Ball when I was young and attending them, that's when they awarded the season's trophies too. They didn't do that, after sailing school as they do now.
I'll be damned. And that was was there a dinner there at the Aqua?
No, there weren't any food facilities there at that time. Our sailor's lunch used to consist of ham and cheese sandwiches down in what was the men's locker room at that time. Yeah.
And was that just where they made the food then for the
Aqua? Some of the wives of the sailors made them and brought them in, platters of them.
I'll be darned. You also have a couple of children, and one of them, or both of them, are very famous. One of them was my queen at White Lake. Your son John is a very famous person now. Can you tell us about him?
Well, I guess if somebody's in the acting business and appears periodically on television or movies, they're considered famous. But John has been making a living for a number of years in the acting business, and he's fine and going to be here in another week or so.
For how long?
We don't know. It depends on, they're talking to him about a engagement right now, so that's something in his business that you don't know.
Yeah, you just have to take what you can get, and that's great. When you were growing up, did you used to have the docks starts at the yacht club? Did you always have the races start between the mark and the dock?
Right. Right, always started and finished off the end of the dock.
Do you think that should be brought back,
they all like the upwind start out in the lake, and of course when you're starting off the dock, why sometimes you started downwind and such, and I don't know when they abandoned the end of the dock starts, but and went to the. Well, I guess it's when they first got the original Petunia was when, you know, that committee boat. Back in the Clem Harvey days, I think he was involved in that, and Clem Harvey, Fred Fischel, all that crowd. I don't know, but we were just remarking the other day that you used to go to the Yacht Club on Saturday to watch the start and the finish of the sailboat races, and they frequently, during the course, they ran them around the club mark, so they may have not only have started or finished there, but they also sometimes came around the mark during the race. But so you're saying you used to go to the Yacht Club on Saturday to watch sailboat races, now you go for the social occasion of sailor's lunch, and then everybody goes home because they can't see the races from where they are unless you go out in the lake in a boat. I don't know whether it's a plus.
Yeah, that's good. We have a ghost here.
You need to turn it off?
No, you can go ahead and ask. Oh, you're going to ask a question? Well, I'll tell you what, we're actually finished, so we'll just end right here and Martha, ask your question.
I was just going to mention one thing that I thought you might be interested in. Due to my sailing at the Yacht Club and especially racing on the A-boats and the E-boats and working the foredeck on them, you find out if you've been groomed at the White Lake Yacht Club, you can say on the A-boats and the E-boats and even on the C's and M's, you can go out and sail anybody, any place with anybody. You'll fit in very easily. And I moved to Chicago, as I mentioned, to work for a couple of years for our company in 1939. And got on one of the racing boats there, a class boat that a cousin of my father's was involved in. And through that, I got on my first Mackinac in 1939. And it was just, I was just amazed how, you know, I was kind of in awe of big boats and Mackinac boats and everything. But if you've learned here at White Lake, if you've been through the sailing school here and learned to sail and race, especially on the A's and E's, I'll say, with spinnakers and such, you can go race anywhere. I sailed 33 Mackinac races after starting there in 1939. And incidentally, I should mention one. Well, you asked who the good sailors were around here. Another great one was Bill Hodgson. And Bill and I sailed a lot of Mackinacs together, and then we both were involved in I sailed the Bermuda race for 20 years. That's every other race, every other year, I mean, the Newport Bermuda race. But the summer before Bill was killed in that tragic airplane crash, we sailed across the Atlantic in a race together from Bermuda to Spain. And sailing school at the White Lake Yacht Club led me into a wonderful career of sailing, and we've chartered all over the Caribbean and the Greek islands and various other places, Bahamas and such. So, but it all started right here.
Do you have any other insight into anything around White Lake that you'd like to comment on like that? That was wonderful.
I don't know, but it was a marvelous place to grow up, and it's still a great place to be.
The most magical.
I certainly have very wonderful memories of your grandfather, of Clarence Pitkin, and his and his work around the Yacht Club. And I still maintain that one of the greatest things that ever tied the summer colony together was his White Lake Yacht Club news that we got year round. You know. His ditty bag in there, ditty box in there. What, ditty bag, ditty box?
The ditty box.
And, he was an amazing guy at gleaning news from everybody and keeping in touch in the winter with people, you know. And
I guess he did write a lot to people.
Oh, I can remember so well coming into the drugstore, and he was behind the counter, and he'd ask you these innocuous questions and you'd get an answer, and out would come that notebook. He always had his notebook and pencil there to getting items for the Yacht Club news. No, he was a terrific guy. I remember when he was racing around White Lake in a little outboard boat called a Hooten safety plane.
A Hooten safety plane?
Yeah. There was a man in the boat business over in Grand Rapids by the name of Gordon Hooten. And he was a brother of the Runyon boy's mother. Marion Runyon was, her maiden name was Marion Hooten. And Gordon Hooten, in the early days of successful, somewhat reliable outboard motors, built the Hooten safety plane and the Hooten V plane and the Hooten Resorter. And he used to bring them up here to try them out and take us kids for rides in them. But your grandfather had a little Hooten safety plane by in the 26, 27, 28. He was racing around White Lake on his knees driving this little outboard speedboat.
And I think I've seen a picture of that. It's kind of like the hydrofoil we call it.
Hydroplane, yeah. Yeah, it was a step boat. And he had one, and Harry Garner had one. I don't know who else. But they really raced around when they get the engine started, which was most of the time.
Yeah, I hadn't thought too much about that, but that Yacht Club news must have tied everything together for decades.
Oh, you bet it did. You bet it
Everybody
did.
Yeah. I remember as a kid, so we watched for that every month.
Absolutely. We used to, when that White Lake Yacht Club news had come, I shouldn't say this because my sister-in-law has been the editor of the main sheet the last 5 years, but it's nothing they've had since then has ever equal the White Lake Yacht Club news that your grandfather, and I'm sure your grandmother had quite a bit to do with that too, didn't she?
I think so, but I think that was mainly Clarence's movie. Yeah. It was his love.
But that was, when I was doing this article on the A-boats, why Neil Manny, he has some bound copies of the Yacht Club News. He says your grandfather used to give a bound copy, a year's collection of the Yacht Club News to good friends for Christmas.
Yeah, we still have them all bound.
Do you?
Day one.
And Neil gave me the ones from about 1927 on through 35 that I got a lot of the information on the A-boats out of. Fascinating to read.
Yeah, there were
even a couple articles by me in there.
Oh, really?
Yep.
We'll have to get those out.
I went cruising up the lake with George Quimby and a guy named Dick Schwartz and Bill McDonald. First time I went cruising up the lake in 1933. Dick Schwartz had acquired this boat his father had from Al Pack through Harry Pillinger and his father, who owned the boat. They were operating the Bartow Boat Works at that time. Anyway, we went cruising. They persuaded George Quimby to take Dick Schwartz cruising up the lake, and he recruited two of us to go along. And we went down to the World's Fair in Chicago in it that year, too, in 1933.
Holy.
33 or 4, maybe it was. Anyway, I wrote an article about it for the Yacht Club News that is in there.
Speaking of the Yacht Club News, there was another name that was always in there, and I used to read the column. It was very funny.
Just a minute.
It was Phil Van Cez. Phil
Van Deventer wrote about the golf club in there, and those were some of the most humorous columns. That was one of the first. Tessa, no. No. Hey.
Hollywood.
Here, come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Those were some of the most humorous columns that were ever written. Those were one of the first things you turned to in there.
Yeah, I guess he was a character.
Oh, he had such a quiet guy with the most delightful sense of humor. You know, he was Bill Van Deventer's and Peggy's younger brother, and he was wonderful.
I'll be darned. Well, Mr. Getz, I want to thank you very much for your time.
You're very welcome, Joe. It's been fun visiting with you.
You're
nice to listen to the ramblings of an old man.
Oh, I love it. We're going to make a history out of this and keep it. But thank you very much. And if there's something that you think of, if you want to call me, feel free to, because I'll come back and we'll add on.
Okay.
And I mean that sincerely. Because
okay.
This is probably the last chance all we'll right. be able to get all this stuff going. So if there's anything that comes up, just please call
all
me.
Right.
Anything you want, just yell. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Yeah, the kid Phil and James and Tim, I think, just did it the other day, too.
And then another one was to going canoeing up the old channel, you know, years ago.
That's right. Yeah. What did you used to try to find the source like we did?
Yeah, sure. Never
did
found
you ever
it.
Found? No, no. We never found it. No. John Mill and I spent like a whole day we set aside.
We did do that in those days, yeah.
Oh, that's great. And let me get these pictures here, too. I want to get these on tape. Great, Mr. Getz. I really appreciate this. This is great. Now, this is the sailboat you refer to in the tape where you sail out and row back in?
No keel, no centerboard. It was an old rowboat that drifted in on the shore.
And you found
that sail was in the branch garage, that old sail, when they had just purchased that cottage. And We cut a sapling in the woods for a mast. There was no mast with it, so we rigged that up. And
I'll be darned.
Their grandmother made that pirate flag on the sail, or that pirate emblem.
Now, how many years did this last?
This was about 1925, 26, around in there. Probably one or two summers.
Oh, my God.
Take a look at the size of that beach we had at that time.
Yeah, no kidding.
Isn't that something?
Can you name some of the people in there?
Oh, yes, I can name them all. The two Bryants are in there, and I am in there, and then some of my sisters and some of the Harper family, who are distant cousins of ours from Moline, who have a cottage here.
Can you point yourself out for me, just so we'll have a...
Can you stop just a minute?
Sure. That's you right there. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, that's great. Okay, and that other picture too. That's
you want that one. What do you want? Put it here.
Yeah, that's great.
Now, this is the class of 1927?
The White Lake Yacht Club Sailing School class of 1927, the second year of the sailing school.
What was the first year of the Pirates Ball? There's a dispute over it.
I have no idea.
Okay, because there
is... That I can't tell you anything about.
Okay.
Can you... Are you getting that
out? Oh, yeah. Yeah, this camera works great. And I'll videotape your stairs if I could.
Sure. Right ahead.
This is the meat.
And those aren't all of them. I got several more that I still have to frame.
You're kidding. And then with Marty, get all the other kids too. Yeah. Jeez.
And these are just my immediate family. My children and grandchildren, think of my sisters and brothers, what they've had. We've had a lot of people in sailing school.
Look at that. Oh yeah, the Getzes have always had people in sailing school, my God.
Been a lot of people in our family have been in there, and been a major part of my life.